Have you ever wondered when you place an order on Amazon.com, what happens behind the scene? What you see on the website, Amazon website, is basically called the UI code. When you click on place order button, it sends an HTTP request to a backend. And in the backend, there is a backend server running, a web server running, which serves those requests. Now that web server can be written in a JavaScript framework called Node.js, or if you're using Python, you can use a framework called Flask. Nowadays, a new web framework has come up, which is called FastAPI. And this video is a beginner video for FastAPI. In this video, we will install FastAPI and we'll play with it a little bit to see what benefit it has to offer over Flask. Let's install FastAPI on your computer first. I'm assuming you have Python installed, which comes with pip. So you will run pip install FastAPI. And it is as simple as that. You also need to install something called uvcon. So after FastAPI is installed, you will run pip install uvcon. This is the server that you'll be using to run your FastAPI server. So pip install FastAPI and pip install uvcon. These are the two commands that you run to complete your installation. Now I will write my first FastAPI server. I have opened PyCharm. You can use any editor, Sublime, Notepad++, VS Code, any editor that you're comfortable with. And here I'm going to go into Zen mode. I will be meditating. All right. I will install the FastAPI first by doing this. And then I will create a FastAPI instance. So you're just creating an instance of this class. You can call it app or anything that you feel comfortable with. Then you will write your first endpoint. So I will explain what that endpoint means. Let's say I'm writing a simple function called hello. And that hello endpoint will return me some fixed string. So I'm writing a Python function. It's an async function, okay? And I will say return, for example, welcome. So my code is done. So you see like only 5 lines of code and I have written my first endpoint. Now to run the server, you will use uvcon command. You will say uvcon and then the name of the file. The name of this file, by the way, let me show you, is main.py. okay, so that's the file. So I will use uvcon main, that's a file name, colon app. So you are not using main.py, you're just saying main and then colon app, whatever is the variable name here, and you will do --- reload. I will explain what that reload option is, but when you run it, it says application startup complete and your server is available at this port. This is the host and port, okay? So we'll go to now browser and try to run this link. I'm using Chrome here, and when I run this link, I will say hello. See, I get this thing back. So hello is essentially my entry point, okay? When you are working on, let's say, Amazon placing an order, you know, you might be having URLs like post order. So post order is a typical name of the endpoint which will post an order, you know, or place an order. So these are all called endpoint. It could be post order, it could be get order, it can be anything. It's up to you. It's not like fixed list of strings. You can define it to be anything. So here I'm using hello and hello is returning me welcome. I can change my string and say welcome to FastAPI tutorial, and I have to just save. I don't need to stop my server and rerun it again. See, I did not stop and rerun it, and it automatically reloaded my new code, and that was the purpose of this option. So now when I go back to my browser and refresh it, you see, you can see welcome to FastAPI tutorial. So my code changes I'm doing are dynamically getting reflected into my execution. Now let's make it more interesting. Let's have it such that it takes a parameter where I can say okay the world, and it will say welcome to FastAPI tutorial the world. How do you do that? Well, here you can supply that parameter. So here I'm saying name Okay, and I'm using this bracket. This is more like a Python format string kind of syntax where you are supplying name here, and you can use the same word as a variable name here. And now that name that someone is supplying you in a URL is available here in this variable, and you can just say this. I will use Python's format string, and again, you don't need to reload the server. It's automatically loading those changes on its own. Now, when I refresh it, it's all right. So let me refresh it. So it says, see the wall. You can give any name, like say Tom, and that this string will be passed into name variable, and it will come back in the message. Here we are using get method in HTTP REST protocol. There are a couple of other methods as well. So let's go over them one by one. Get is usually used to greet data. For example, you're looking for iPhone case on Amazon website. When you make that query, the website is making a get request to get you all the iPhone covers. There could be another request called post, which is used to create data. So when you place an order on Amazon website, let's say you are issuing a post query. So this get, post, etc. These are the REST API protocol endpoints. The third one is put, which will be used to update data. So an existing order, you want to update it. And the fourth one, delete. Obviously, if you want to delete any data, like deleting an order, you will use this endpoint. Now, there are other endpoints as well, but these four are the popular ones. Now, while working on this tutorial, let's say you got hungry and you went to Grubhub to order some food. And let's say you are looking for Indian food, and this is showing you all the Indian restaurant, and it might show you all the Indian kind of recipes. So let's say you are a backend engineer working in Grubhub, and you want to write an endpoint where you can say something like get item. So let me just show you here. You can maybe say, let's say get items and Indian, and it will return you the Indian food items which are available. Okay, so I'm going to just change this entry point, and I will say get items, and this is the name of my cuisine, and that comes here as a variable. This function name can be anything, it doesn't have to be get items. And let's say, you know, I'm retrieving my item records from a database, but I don't have a database here. So I will just use a simple dictionary where I'm saying, okay, Indian cuisine means these many recipes. Okay, I love samosa, by the way. American means these recipes and so on. And here you can just use food items dot get cuisine. So if someone is supplying Indian cuisine, it will return this one. So let's try this out really quickly. We are very hungry. Okay, this is hello. Hello didn't work. I will say get items Indian. Get items Indian is not working. Actually, it was reloading. I did not wait enough. So when I refresh this, I am getting, see, Indian items, samosa and dosa. All right, let's try some Italian food. Ravioli and pizza. Okay, how about Mexican? Well, we don't have Mexican, so then this get will return null. But this is not ideal. Actually, you want to give user a message that in my website the only supported cuisines are Indian, American and Italian. Now let's talk about the benefit of FastAPI over Flask. So the first benefit is that in Flask, if you have to do this kind of data validation, then you will do something like if cuisine in, or if cuisine not in, let's say Indian. So you'll have to write a code like this where I have just said food items dot keys, which will be Indian, American and Italian, and you will say if cuisine not in this, then return this message that only valid supported cuisines are Indian, you know, American and Italian. Now see, This is a very simple function. You might have a big function with a lot of validation. And when you are using framework like Flask, you have to do all this validation yourself, which is not ideal. What if the framework itself gives you some validation? So that's what FastAPI can do it for you. It can give this validation for free. And I will explain how. So I'm just going to remove this code here. And I have imported enum in Python, and enum is used if you have fixed category of things. And I'm going to create a class which will have all three cuisines are specified as enum. So see, these are my available cuisines. And now here you can just use Python's type hint and say available cuisines. So you're saying that cuisine has to be from these available cuisine. Now this is a type hint. Python is not a statically typed language, so if you run the code just like that, it's not going to do anything. But FastAPI understands now that the user or the backend engineer is expecting cuisine to be one of these three, and if you don't supply the cuisine which is, you know, part of this list, let's see what happens. So here, once again, if I supply Indian, things are going to just work as fine. But when I say Mexican, it will give me an error that it is not valid. The valid values are these three. So see, you don't have to write that validation code here. And this is benefit number one that FastAPI offers: inbuilt data validation. It is a huge benefit. It can make your code really compact because you don't have to do all this validation yourself. It can also reduce bugs. So you see a very nice error here. I quickly wrote a second function. Let's say on your Grubhub website, you have some coupon codes, you know, and 1, 2, 3 are coupon code IDs, and these are the relevant amount in percentages of for those coupon codes. And you can have another endpoint called get coupon and code. And now code, you expect it to be only integer. So using type hint again, you are saying it has to be integer. Okay. And let's see if it is not integer. So I go back here. I will say get coupon. And when I say 1, you know, I get 10%. When I say 2, I get 20%. But if I do ABC, it will again tell me that value is not valid. Integer value is not a valid integer, it has to be integer. So again, the data validation in FastAPI is super awesome. The second big benefit of FastAPI is the inbuilt documentation. So you can do /docs and it will generate the documentation for you. See, I didn't have to write anything. This could be very useful for front-end engineer who is using your backend, because that way they will know what you are expecting in your API. For example, in get cuisine, you are expecting only Indian, American, Chinese. So if you click on this try it out button, see, it is showing you that these are the three valid cuisines. And you can also send a test request. So if I say Indian and if I execute, you know, see, I'm getting very delicious samosa and dosa bag, which I can eat and increase my programming productivity. You know, American, execute, hot dog, apple pie. So this is giving you a nice taste pad to test out your APIs. You can also use a different kind of documentation. So FastAPI, again, if you do /docs, you get this documentation. If you do redoc, you know, redoc, that's another way of generating documentation. So see, here it's some generates like response and response samples as well, so you can just explore it. It's pretty useful. This is the official website of FastAPI, and if you click on tutorials, they have amazing quality tutorials. I have not seen tutorials of such a great quality, very simple, easy to understand on any other technology frameworks. Okay, so I highly recommend you go through all these tutorials, because I just covered the basics of FastAPI, compared it with Flask, but there are so many things, you know, so many options available. For example, form data. Form data is a usual thing when you're doing UI coding in your JavaScript, and you can directly import that form class here in the FastAPI backend, and you can do various things with it. You know, you get some ready-made functionality. So explore these options and you're going to absolutely love the documentation of this portal. While coding, we covered the two big benefits of FastAPI, which was inbuilt data validation, and the second was inbuilt documentation support. There are few other benefits as well. For example, the benefit number three is that the FastAPI, as the name suggests, is actually very fast. The way it is written, it gives you the best performance. So your server will run almost at the speed of, you know, Node.js server. So the performance, runtime performance is beautiful. So that's benefit number three. Benefit number four is the code that you're writing is very compact. And as a developer, it will take you very less time to write FastAPI code. So it's a compact code. The code development is very fast and there are very few bugs. So just to quickly summarize, four benefits: inbuilt data validation, inbuilt documentation support. The runtime performance is pretty good. It is very fast and the development time is also very less and there are less bugs. I hope you liked this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. And if you have any question, post in a comment box below.